So this project is to reminisce and to tell of my encounters with these curious people that I've ended up living and working with and traveling around the world with. And the list sort of goes on and on. We are here at Emily Harvey Foundation in Venice because they have a retreat that they offer residences to writers and artists in the lovely quarters here, right in central Venice, right near the Rialto. So we're in what I call the ambiente sociale. You have all of the services and the people and the entertainment within walking distance. Being one of the rare cities that have no automania. So here we are in the quiet of Venice to imagine or to remember.
Well, I think part of this memorializing is also the story of your antics, including arrests and vacating the premises out of threats to life and limb.
Mm.
Let's not forget those.
Well, I've had more than 9 lives. That's all I can say. I have been variously a vagabond and a refugee and a fugitive and incarcerated and falsely accused and released and then entertained and had many an adventure around the world. But my interest here is to tell the adventures of the mind of which this community that comes, this particular sponsorship has a wide variety of writers, artists, painters, poets, etc., that have come to know Emily Harvey and the foundation as sort of a wellspring of human imagination. And we ourselves are individuals, at least in our corporal state, but our life is very much made of other people and our encounters and collaborations and conflicts are the essence of what becomes your life. And you don't have one life, you actually have many lives. That is your physical being and your family life and your economic life and your love life and your life of the spirit, life of the mind, your imagination, your dream life, all these things.
And how you appear in the New York Times.
Well, hopefully your
published life.
Your published life is a good shadow of your multidimensional life. That's where I know a lot of these people because we work together in productions, either print or music or theater or film, and so I have the possibility of describing the kind of contacts with people who had all kinds of other lives that I didn't know, except that particularly having gone to New York City and not knowing what was going to happen, so many things happened, and especially around my my life at the Ear Inn on Spring Street, where I moved in as a college student with my college buddies. And it's always been sort of a guest house, people moving in and out and staying and coming and going a lot over the old pub, which is now well known as a bistro pub music spot, not really a club because we don't charge admission. And many people have come through there beyond myself and my friends.
Smoke cigarettes, drink coffee too, honey. You're the reason I don't sleep at night. Yep.
maybe it was Alwyn Nikolai, I'm trying to remember who was there. They had a dance studio. So then I met the aerodance team and Branya and Stephanie Evanitsky, the director, who had their dancers in the air with what they call multi-gravitational aerodance, which was the first time a real troupe had gotten together to do it outside of, let's say, the circus and trapeze as a boutique dance concert.
And this was all on bungee cords?
They had a large scaffolding, they had lines down, they had harnesses, they had nets, they had various things, but they developed movement. Curiously, Stephanie Evanitsky had been a classical Russian-style ballet dancer who decided to get off her toes, as she put it, and go flying, every ballerina's dream. And so then she created this company, and I was at the time working on my live electronics and my other things that I was doing in the electronic music studio. And so I somehow ended up to be the musician for suddenly I was on tour with them and making up things of my own at the time. And so one day at the city center, yeah, we had a 3-week run of, you know, 4 days a week, whatever the slot was. And our studio was within walking distance. So it was a lot easier than dragging ourselves around touring, which I did for a couple of years with them. But in the door came early with his entourage, Salvador Dali and his wife Gala, and maybe a driver or one of his colleagues or somebody, and he was, you know, sat down in the front row with his big hat on and his cane, and I didn't recognize him, but finally by the, because I was busy setting up because I was a live performer, and so then in the flutter of the end of our set, somebody said, go over and talk to him. That's that guy Dali. And I was a rube from New Mexico. What do I know? They all look like cowboys to me with those big hat and all this. Because I could speak some Spanish, I would up and say, hola, señor Dali. Tu nombre, Dali, ¿qué quiere decir eso? Es un nombre muy extraño, ¿no? Oh, sí. And so I started talking to him enough so that, hey, what are you, blah, blah, blah. And so he would come to our concerts, because then he asked, through me, his interpreter. He actually switched to French, but because he didn't like Castilian. He was Catalan, Barcelonan. He asked me at one point, could he join the company and we would rig him up so he could fly? And we said, well, that's, because he thought, why not him too up there? Of course, he was about 75 years old. He was living at the St. Regis Hotel in the wintertime when he had his studio there for the month or three. And we realized that, well, maybe he's not physically fit to go get twisted around on ropes up there. So we said, well, we'll do a little event with you at your studio, which happened to be the St. Regis Hotel on Fifth Avenue, in the lobby, all marble and mahogany and wrought iron and flowers and this beautiful little micro elegant palace where he had a whole side of the the building is his painting studio. And we hung Branya on the staircase with the chandelier, and she danced around him. And that's the photo I took of Dali with the great dancer Branya, who was all twisted, and he's, you know, posing and all of that. And he turned around, and somebody made a film of that. One of his people had a little film camera, because he was followed by people all the time. Well, we never got him off the ground because we didn't want to break his hip. And so then we would have, I would go up there and see him now and again after the before and after this event. That, we would have breakfast with him at 6 p.m. when he just got up, came down to the public dining area where he had a giant table, and people would come to see him then. And at 6 to 7 o'clock, he had worked all night, slept all day, and he would say, "Oh, New York is a great city because I can make so much money while I'm asleep," being that he would work all sketching and finally just signing his name and selling pieces of paper with it. And his gallerist would come and get it in the morning. And by the evening, when Dali woke up, he would have sold thousands of dollars worth of his, you know, fresh stuff. And so I went with Paco and with Jeff Hewitt to see him once. I think it may be even Christine Lehner came also once, but I would say, "Let's go up and have breakfast with Salvador Dali." And, oh, well, you know. So Shari came once, and she had met him before. She said, "Oh, that kind of a clown of a Spaniard," as I think is what she called her. Because I said this, she told the story of his working on the window, Bonwood Teller or whatever, the Fifth Avenue Mall started window displays for the season. And supposedly he had a commission to set up a tableau with the fur. And then he said, "Well, I'll line the bathtub with fur and I'll get in it and I'll pretend to take a bath in a fur bathtub. How's that for a night?" "Oh, okay, go right in." They lent him the furs and whatever happened. He also managed somehow to, I don't know if he had much water, but he actually did take a bath, supposedly, with water in the bath on the fur. And then the commotion on the avenue was how high when he, whatever happened, he was getting out of the bathtub. The whole thing fell over, broke the window, out onto the street. The police came. The store had to pick up their furs and clean up the sidewalk and kick him out.
Well, this would have, you see, he
whatever year, if it ever happened.
It was in the 50s because his signature is in the Black Visitor Book.
Well, he was a gad about town. And, yeah. You know. And so, I mean, this story, I have not ever had the time to tell more about just this particular curious mind that, so, you know, he was like a grandfather, and I was 22 or 3. And
in 75, you would have been 24.
Yeah, I would have turned that year. But he was right in those years. By 77, the year end opened, and he was already gone. Well, he was still alive, I think, but he never came back to New York. What he did, he would come over after New Year, and he'd stay till maybe April. And he'd do all this work and had a gallery and selling stuff. And then he'd spend the time summer at his house in Portly Guy. He invited me to come there, said, "Come stay with me, you know." But above all, he went on with Shari. He knew Shari. And so Shari, "Comme vous bien, nous visitons un petit déjeuner plus, you know, plus de bonheur." So he came for lunch or breakfast at about 2 p.m. down to the year end with a limousine waiting outside. And the guys in the bar gawking, "What's that limousine doing here?" And he and Shari served him a little cerveau d'agne au beurre noir de capre, so grazed lamb brains in burnt butter with capers, you know, garlic and a local dish, I think, from Catalonia, because his fishing port town, I don't know where, I remember Dali said, "Oh, if I eat these brains, will it make me more intelligent?" You know, something like that.
Do you know if he liked it?
No, he ate it up. I mean, it's a local dish. Called in, you know, it has a fancy name in French, but in other places called the leftovers or the sweetmeats. That's what the polite butchery will call it, sweetmeat and glands and, you know, liver and all that kind of stuff. Aren't you getting hungry now? But anyway, you know, there I was sitting at lunch table with Shari Dienes and Salvador Dali, and, you know, I'll say, hey, well, we'll get that. You never know who you'll meet around that table. Later became the poker table. Or was at the same time. He at the time, when we go up and, you know, we didn't, you know, go work in the stew. We'd always meet him at his lounge where he'd be having an omelet and coffee at 6 p.m. And Gala, and he was always, you know, talking and deeply involved with his wife, who was sort of a great lioness of a woman. She sort of had him enthralled, and he would always, you know, ask her what she thought of things, and, you know, he would always introduce her, and she'd, oh, this, you know. So Gala, in the history of his life, was this great inspiration, and she was not very friendly to all the footlings and, you know, wannabes that came to see him. He would invite people to have breakfast, but She had just gotten up or was just back from shopping, probably. But he was working at the time on painting lima beans or fava beans with little microscopic portraits. This is what he told me. I never actually saw them because he was doing this somewhere else. But he was telling me about it. Said, it's fantastic when you paint, you know, then you can really look. And he used a kind of a jeweler's lens to do it very delicately. And of course, he was a master technician of painting. So he did ones of Marilyn Monroe and Charlie Chaplin and I don't know who else. He was doing a whole series of them. But the reason was that he had a filmmaker who had a time-lapse camera and a mountain, and then he would film the beans, put them in water, and then over a week, he would film the beans sprouting through the face of the celebrity. And I said, well, that's a fantastic, gigantic movie out of something very, very small. And I don't know if it's ever been shown or whether he finished it or just imagined doing it. But anyway, and he said, Richard, you know, if I fais un peu de musique pour le grand explosion de face or whatever it was in French, my memory is maybe in the wrong language. But so that's where I wrote my orchestral piece on a toothpick for Dali. I think in the catalog it's called For Dali. It's on a wooden toothpick.
A flat toothpick.
No, a round toothpick. No, you know, you have to be stylish about these things, because then the score is verbal and written in micro. I had to have, a jeweler's lens to do the microscopic writing, and the instructions of the orchestra is all ascend in slow, all ascend range in slow pulse. Six words. And it's every member of the orchestra or ensemble starts on their lowest note, and then the conductor with the toothpick conducts the pulse. To that point, you know, however big the orchestra is or the instrumentation, the kettle drums run out after four pulses. The tuba has 20 notes. And so the whole thing starts, and then it becomes a race. So who can play the longest with the highest range? Usually won by the French horns. Meanwhile, the rest of the orchestra members are sort of saying, hey, my part's already done. What? That's no fair. And so watching the flutes, you know, and the violins. So it's a novelty piece, as they politely called it, when it was performed around a few places.
What?
I have a recording of it with an orchestra.
Who was conducting?
This was some festival upstate. I'd have to dig in the archive. It's in Charlie Morrow's archive. This was a long time ago. You understand this?
Did Dali ever hear it?
No. We didn't have it performed. I didn't have it recorded for a number of years until later. But I did send copies to Michael Tilson Thomas, who used to come into the Ear Bar, and I gave one to Seijo Ozawa. You know, I was kind of mad for this piece to get played. Here, have my score. Just like every other hustling young composer, you got to give them a copy. And some of them probably used it on their teeth, but I never got a major orchestra to do it. Though, again, it's been performed some places in Europe via my various nefarious friends who stage concerts and don't tell me what they're doing sometimes.
When you went to visit Dali's house, did they have the toothpick score?
Oh, I don't know. I think he used it on his teeth like any sensible artist would.
But the house was not solidly built.
Oh, this was a house ready to be demolished. It was crooked, fallen in, broken windows, bare electrical outlets that had been put in the 30s or so, and no heat. We had fireplaces without flues. We had to put in a toilet and get the place residential. It had been used as a flop house. Every door had a lock on it. There were false walls to separate rooms that had once been one room. They cut into two little bunk bed kind of rooms, and they'd rent it out either by the night or by the hour. And so we cleared it out, but it had been packed in with old audio TV equipment because this was part of Radio City with the Bell Labs and all the Canal Street electronic shops where Radio City, the name came from, is out. That's where the transistor was invented and the tubes and all these things that made the whole electronic culture. And
Mickey,
the sailor who had retired up there, started a TV radio repair shop upstairs, and except that he didn't know how to do anything. And he only put up a shingle and said, I'll repair your radio and TV, all these big wooden cased tube amp devices, and he would take in a $5 deposit and then come back in a couple of weeks, Mrs. McGillicuddy, and I'll see if I fix it. Well, he never fixed anything. He only lived off the deposits. And he said, I'm sorry, you really should buy the new one because it's really much better. And so the room by room filled up to the ceiling with all these old TVs and radios. And we thought, oh, what a bunch of junk. And so we spent days clearing it out, throwing it in every trash bin we could find. And, of course, the irony being that would have been a gold mine for what they call the archaeology of electronics now. And I saved a few of the cases and a couple of the old TV sets. One of the TV sets we put down in the bar when we took over the lease on the business downstairs. And there was this old round TV set from 1940 or so that had a beautiful cabinet, and we would plug it in and it would just have wave patterns because it didn't have the antenna and whatever the reception is. We were hoping it would play I Love Lucy, but that didn't come on. So people would just stare at the wave patterns of the oscillator kind of thing until one evening somebody spilled a drink on it and it started smoking and started to catch fire. We had to rush it out into the street before it burnt the house down.
Well, it sounds like a preamble to Nam June's work.
Yes, I really, well, he came over. He may have taken a couple of them, come to think of it, because when Sari was living there, he would come over all the time, and he was sort of hung out at the Ear and particularly liked to just sit and ask Sari questions. And I probably gave him a few of these TV sets, but the what I made for others in these wooden radio cases that were often Gothic or screens and little knobs and stuff, as I would take out all the electronics and put in a cricket cage and then go down to the pet shop, buy a bunch of crickets and then a bunch of lettuce and stuff, and then they would chirp all the time. So it was a radio that had living chirping sounds.
This was the beginning of the transducers, huh?
Oh, this was just the cricket chorus. Except the problem is crickets are not very friendly to each other, and after so many weeks or months, there'd only be one big fat one chirping because it had eaten all the other ones. Sort of like an artist community that way.
Could say I've been a student of hers for many years, just being a good friend of hers. And perhaps someday, when I am as young as she is, I will have a similar amount of energy and discipline. Well, now I would like to just play a little bit of music for Sari on my instrument, the guqin, which is the ancient Chinese lute instrument I've been playing for a little while, and was featured in our sounding of the I Ching concert.
Last night.
Well, last night, last year, whenever you see this, it was in the past.
The, what were they, the
the plastic things that went up with Dee Dee Halleck?
The zilch.
The zilches. Tell that. That's an incredible story. Dee Dee Halleck's a filmmaker, right? Who's a friend of Shari's, too.
I'd call teenage pranks in that. In the winter, when it was the bitter cold, she would have a zilch party at her house in their garden, and it would be the depth of January, February, and she'd have a dinner party or something, and everybody would bring plastic laundry bags, that very film...
dry cleaner bags.
Dry cleaner bags, that kind of gooey plastic that's just sheet, simple sheet, and then she'd show how you tie a series of knots, and then you get a big string out of each one. Then we'd go out hanging out on the trees, and when it was dark, you light the bottom with a lighter on the plastic, and it burns, but it bubbles and it hisses, and then it drips and makes a particular. The hot bubbles as it hit the air, and then it hit the stone, it sizzles. And we all sit around, wow, this is here. Where's the tequila? Or, I mean, Mashari was not a drug aficionado, didn't need marijuana or LSD and all the stuff that was typically how people see silly stuff like that. She always is that marvelous. Oh, let's make some more. We sit around. Of course, this is highly toxic and highly dangerous. And when the spring come, we'd have to kind of clean up the carbonized plastic that was getting in the way of the flowers.
Toxic.
Yeah, it was very toxic. It was a beauty made of time.
And I was at Ear In a lot, so I would think I had seen her at some point there, because I used to cherish what they were doing. It was the best bass for all of us. I won't even call it alternative. It was bass, basic.
What was the atmosphere like there?
Oh, it's just heaven. You know, first of all, it's old. We like that. It's not slick and modernized and... it's Rip's vision of how we can all gather and coalesce and present things. It's very flexible. It has a big open upstairs wooden sort of presentation area. Downstairs you can drink and eat. It was just the best place to go.
But anyway, I was with a bit of a rolling circus of friends and visitors, and the Ear Inn in the upstairs apartment was always full of visitors or roommates. I mean, we had 6-8 people living up there sometimes. But Shari had the main bedroom. When she wasn't there, other people would use it, but she was the roommate there for 15 years until she was too ill to come and hang out and go to see things. And the house goes on, but without her, we would have all been evicted back in
77
is when she
signed up.
Harry, the old owner of the bar, who was Hungarian, would, in spite of the objections of the curmudgeon sitting at the stools, he'd call her to the back room. She wasn't allowed to sit in the front room or at the bar at all, but they'd gone on in Hungarian. And that's how it happened, is that Harry, who wanted to sell and retire, he was a refugee from Hungary, just like Shari. And at one point he said, why don't you buy it and, you know, put these young guys to work, which is what happened. She made a deal, and we were suddenly cooking and cleaning and serving downstairs, and then it's gone on since that. But without her willingness to do that, it wouldn't have happened. Shari and I did quite a few performances together. I just pulled out the poster of the Dharma Music Festival where she performed her I Ching casting and singing of it while I played Chinese lute, Alan Zimmerman on percussion. There's a film of it somewhere.
What about the poker?
Well, that was, this is what led to much of this contact in the world, is that Sari would host a Wednesday night poker game, an early one. It's, you know, probably about, started about 6 o'clock in the evening. So people would come and go through the evening until they'd had enough of it, because she...
She didn't cheat.
She didn't cheat much, no. No, she was always a gracious host, and so early lose, late win. And this was big stakes. There was a dime, quarter, or the maximum bet was $1. And so there was tens of dollars won ferociously on the side of this round table that... still in our kitchen now, but it...
Bobby Bucher's.
Bobby, I think Bobby Bucher gave it so we would have a proper table. Probably at the ear end, the front room, meeting room where it was so slanted, there had to be 1 inch from one side of the table to the other, which meant that... And Sari would sit on the low end, so eventually most of the chips and most of the money would fall into her lap. And, oh, well, I have to go. Thank you for the party. Oh, it was so wonderful. I love you very much and see you next time.
So, who were attending, you can remember? Did Bobby come?
Yeah, Bobby Bucher and I remember the Michael O'Shaughnessy, who was one of the founders of the National Lampoon. And
did John come?
John Cage came. He's a teetotaler, so he lost his few quarters and politely went back up to Bank Street, where he was living at the time, a walk away. And, I don't know, maybe Dick Higgins came. Namjoon Paik, I think, was there. Ray Johnson.
Ray played poker?
Well, I just remember him being around. He, in those early days, I had no idea who these people were.
Albert?
They were just sort of... Albert Fine, he didn't have a quarter in his pocket. I don't think he ever played. He was...
Did Phil come? Niblock?
Phil, I don't remember Phil Niblock there. But John Lennon came. That's when I met John Lennon. Because he was a... Sari was an old friend of Yoko Ono's. And... they had been in events and things, and so they were...
This was before the picnic?
Later, they came up to the land picnic. But first, they came down with limo running outside, and John would come up for a number of hands. Yoko didn't come. She didn't play poker. And she was, you know, busy with her own life, but...
And none of the other Beatles?
No, I know. This was after the Beatles, and... When Lennon was under he was under orders to be deported for his immigration status and having a conviction for pot in England, and the federal prosecutors were trying to process him right out of the country, just as he was living up with Yoko up at the Dakota.
I think you were coming around to getting a job with John Lennon.
Yes, that was later in that...
was that through Machunas?
Yes, Machunas. I was working, you know, on and off with he and Yoshi and, we were plumbing and sanding floors and demolition. And I had enough experience and I'd worked construction jobs on and off through my nomadic childhood, because we always moved every year of my childhood and renovated a house. but so I was willing to do all that kind of work. And so I believe it was Yoko wanted to have a playroom just for Sean, their son. And so George Machunas, they asked him, they said, can you find somebody who can design and build this thing? So with George, we sketched out a series of boxes, and a stack of boxes that would fill the corner of a room at their very vast apartment at the Dakota upon Central Park West. And so I went up there a number of days a week and started assembling plywood boxes, maybe 2 foot by 2 foot by 2 foot deep. And so they were big enough for this little kid who was 4 or 5 at the time to crawl around and get in. So I went and got various materials. So one box had lined with fur, and one box had tinsel, and another one had Christmas tree lights, and one of them had big velvet lips. You could crawl in the mouth and sit inside and look out. And so for, I don't know how long, a month or two, I was up there regularly. Between, by that time, the pub had opened, and so I was also maybe working in the kitchen at the Ear Inn, and this was sort of my side construction job. And at the time, John Lennon had been a friend coming to play poker, and then when we started Ear Magazine, he donated $100 cash to pay the printing bill of our first editions. He and John Cage were our encourager in that. The music rag that went on for a whole 18 years after that. But anyway, I ended up sort of being friends with John Lennon. At the time, you know, I knew the Beatles, but I didn't really, you know, I wasn't a pop musician myself. I could play some guitar and I appreciated his music. But at the time, he was writing and drawing and staying out of the public eye until his court case was settled. He was either going to be deported or suddenly what happened, he was absolved of all charge, deportation order because of interference in his case. And the federal judge famously let him go, dismissed the whole thing because the Nixon White House had directly interfered to try to make sure he was kicked out of the country and not continue influencing the youth.
What was the saying?
Oh, when he got absolved and he went down to the courthouse steps and the reporters say, "Well, Mr. Lennon, what do you think about your charges being released? Now you're a free man and can stay in the United States. And how do you think about that?" And he looked around and he said, "It goes to show that time wounds all heals." Which I think got back to Nixon and John Mitchell or the feds and the prosecutors, and they just couldn't stand the satire. That bad enough that he got let off with no punishment, but he also made fun of them. They were suddenly free to do what they wanted, and we published in Ear Magazine one of their first page descriptions of their view of the world and such, and so, you know, John Lennon was sort of key to our world at that time, and but most terribly, he was murdered, or I'd say assassinated, probably by the underside of the government, if there could ever be exposed. But the real tragedy is that this, in 1980, he had been absolved by then, and he was writing and planning to record, and they'd, of course, every studio in the city and back in London wanted to host him, but he wanted to have his own studio to do his own personal kind of private work. He had a little tape recorder and his guitar and a little music room upstairs in the residence, but he had rented out the basement back area at the courtyard of the Dakota, which was down at street level, but in the back of the building and very quiet. And so we were renovating it, clearing it out, and we had ordered cabinetry and were beginning a equipment list to set up his own private studio. And I was going to be the engineer. I mean, I was working with him building stuff and coming in and out of the Dakota. And so we were talking, do you want to have an isolation voice booth? Do you have big a mixer? Do you want, you know, I had enough, you know, audio engineering experience from the mastering studio that this was going to be a working studio that would have produced remarkable things. But instead, he was shot down dead just outside of it at the front door of the building. So that was 1980, December. And I, you know, while I'm on the subject, this is sort of the most painful thing that I ever felt in my life, was his murder. I was not there that week because I had been approached by somebody in the Ear Inn bar while I was the bartender late at night, And this fellow I had an acquaintance with told me I'm in trouble and I better come clean and I better tell him what's going on. And he stayed to the end of the night. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm working here and I'm going up and building this studio uptown. And, I don't see what trouble is. And he kept pressing me. Then he came up and he searched my quarters and there was nothing to see. I mean, I had some papers and writing and musical instruments and my roommates. And he says, well, I don't know what this is about, but I'm going to bring somebody here tomorrow at noon and I want them to question you. And so I and Paco, my roommate at the time, went down and this guy came in with two of the meanest looking men I'd ever seen. And they asked me a couple of questions about if I knew somebody and if I was, and I said, I don't know what you're talking about. We thought that we were getting shaken down for protection or something. They got up and said, no, you're lucky to have this friend. And then later he said, there was a hit put out on you. And I can't tell you anything more except that you're okay. And it's, but you better leave town. And I said, what are you talking about? What am I doing? Publishing dangerously inscrutable music? Or am I playing too loud? No, what's going on? Well, at this point in retrospect, I think that they had considered that I could have been a witness to the assassination of John Lennon had I been around. Because I was there, daily at this point, or often enough so that whatever happened to him may have been implicated myself, except that this fellow that was a neighborhood character, he told me, or somebody later, that he worked in the underside business, let's say, and he had been told that, hey, this guy is in your territory, and what about it? And I don't know what the details are, except that the next day I packed my bag and I left town and ended up going to China and living and working over there for a few years, rather than come back and find out what happened. But I remember I was out in California when December, I think it was 8th, Lennon was killed. It would have been a day I would have been up there with him, working on his studio. And so this is just every time I hear all the songs again or these reviews, and it kind of chokes me up, because this is probably the greatest opportunity I had in my life to work with John Lennon, even just as his engineer. And it was suddenly passed, and I was in exile. It's sort of like when I got chased out the first time by the draft. This time it was by unknown reasons, and I never found out anything more than that.
Well, listen, Rip, why don't we take a break? You've been talking for 45 minutes.
Okay, more to come. Over and out.
Thank you.